the situation in Kashmir is becoming more and more volatile, unpredictable, and violent. Teenagers of today have been born in a time of violence. In fact, people who were born from about 1988 onwards, which is 30 years and more, have been born in a time of violence, raised in a time of violence, and have been inured to violence as a consequence. And they become fearless to the extent that I've been using the word immunized to fear. They've become the children of war. And not only are they the children of war, they're the children of a very fear-filled environment. When you ask why they take up arms, one must understand the kind of milieu in which they grew up and the kind of messaging they've got, the kind of discourses they've heard. In fact, most of the country became conscious of Kashmiri rage after Burhan Wani was killed. And it is to be noted that by September or so 2010, Burhan Wani had gone underground at the age of 15. He was just short of his 16th birthday. After he had been beaten up needlessly, arbitrarily, by special operations policemen. So what's happened is that from around 2009-2010, we've had a new militancy, and I think it's very important to understand that this is a new generation with new patterns. For example, many of them are far more educated. Remember that these young people who are teenagers today did not see the 90s, but they've heard about the 90s in a very one-sided way, about the repression and the terrible human rights abuses of the armed forces, of the army, which has molded their minds and shaped their responses. They've rejected the very concept of nation state. To many of them, and I found this in my survey, the idea of democracy as some kind of Western conspiracy that is meant to weaken their resolve to fight for a kind of caliphate. You must remember that the kinds of narratives that many of us have come across regarding Islamic State is often very different to the kinds of narratives, the kinds of videos that are available on the internet and through social media to young people in places like Kashmir. And teenagers very often accept those narratives very easily. Militancy that began in 1988 had ended more or less by around 2006. The situation on the ground had eased to the extent that AFSPA should have been amended and certainly should have been removed from certain districts. The mass of people in Kashmir, common people, had stopped giving shelter or giving food to militants. They would lock them out. They would say, "We don't want you around. Please go away." So it was becoming very difficult for militants to survive out there. And if at that time the counterinsurgency apparatus had been eased to a considerable extent, then the people would have been even more encouraged to not work with the militants, not allow militants. It seems to me that the continuation of the counterinsurgency apparatus alienated and angered a new generation. Now, one of the things that I've noted is that people in authority, whether they're officials, bureaucrats, or politicians in high office, tend very often to take a cautious line in terms of removing the apparatus of counterinsurgency. So someone maybe 10 years ago or 15 years ago decided that a bunker needed to be put up somewhere. That remained in force because nobody wanted to take the decision that now it's not required any longer, simply because something might happen, and if that happens, then I will be blamed for having removed the... So it's a question of, and that's why I keep talking of the bulletproof glass syndrome. People live in these behind security, do not realize what people outside that security apparatus, outside the network of power and influence, go through on a day-to-day basis. And it could be as simple as just passing by security men on your way to school. Quite frankly, the conflict itself suits a lot of people. whether it's the forces or it's intelligence agencies, quite often those in government, and of course the Hurriyat Conference and other such separatist leaders, all those who are part of or connected with the network of power and influence have, and even the media to a large extent, have benefited or been able to turn conflict to their advantage. It's not just India and Pakistan's agencies disbursing large amounts of money trying to influence the conflict in one way or another. And all of those who are receiving this money have a stake, whether they acknowledge it or not, whether they're even conscious of it or not. Sometimes unconsciously, they develop a vested interest in the continuation of conflict. World powers have used the Kashmir situation to leverage influence in both India and Pakistan. We are major buyers of arms in the international arms market, and whether it's China or the West, at various times have benefited from India-Pakistan antagonism and enmity. And India and Pakistan getting together, the way Mr. Vajpayee had visualized, was obviously not going to be welcome to a lot of those world powers. And everybody must put politics aside, and I believe the entire spectrum of politics in the national scenario and at the local level in the state must work together to try and get past this terrible, terrible cycle of violence. And that's a lot to ask for, I know, particularly in election season, but it's something that the nation needs, and very urgently.